Good morning. Can you guys hear me? Okay, I have the lapel mic on. Very professional. So hopefully this will give better sound to the folks who are joining us via 1079 or online on Facebook and YouTube. Also, I want you to hear what I have to say too. It's not all about them. Did you have a good Thanksgiving?
Yes.
Quiet, nice, meditative, that's what we had. We had a lovely meal, fireside at the manse. It was really lovely. We also, as you can see, we've had some elves visit us. And a big thank you to all of them for doing the greening of the church. It's so beautiful and so festive, and I think we really need that right now. As a reminder, this year we are doing things a little bit differently. Usually you do donations in honor of loved ones who have passed or in memory of, and you get a poinsettia and put it on the altar. This year, the deacons thought it would be really nice if those donations went to something very useful. So when you do your donations in memory of a loved one, the donations will go to Ada's Closet, which is a closet of essentials at the high school for teens in need. So please keep that in mind when you're thinking about your donations. We have forms at the narthex, and I think envelopes too. And my last announcement. Or it's actually not my announcement, it's Judy's announcement.
Well, as you can see, the ministry is getting trimmed. And we started doing it just this past week. We've shown the tree. Now we're going to have it for another 2.5 weeks, and then we'll distribute it to, I'm assuming, the same local 6 charities that we did last year. Now we need mittens, of course, and gloves, and scarves, and hats, and slippers, and even lap blankets. So if you can knit them, or you have something you want to give back to the church, please see that it gets to the office this week, or bring it to service.
When Judy was draping the mitten tree yesterday, all I could think was that was the most beautiful and perfect Christmas decoration, one of giving. If you all would join me in the spirit of prayer. Creating and sustaining God, in your presence there is life. Living water springs up, and deserts bloom where you pass. Seeking the life that comes from you, we have gathered before you. Our hearts are ready, O God. Delight us with your presence, and prepare us for your service in the world. Amen. ask the McCullers, McCullers to come up for the lighting of the Advent calendar. And in the spirit of the light of hope, please join me for this morning's prayer of confession. And please stand if you are able. This has been a year of disquiet and suffering, O God. We live in a world that worships money and brute force, sowing the seeds of fear and hatred. At times we get caught up in this and forget to share your love with everyone. Holy One, shine your face upon us. Restore us to you and the eternal hope only you can bring. Amen. God's love is unwavering. It's eternal. God's blessing has been poured out for all of creation. And nothing can separate you from that blessing. And nothing can separate you from God's love. Remember that today, and remember it every day. Praise be to God. So, I'm kind of interested in this. You all recognize it? It is a?
Advent wreath.
What does Advent mean? Does anyone know? It literally means, oh, yes. Advent is literally to coming. It's sort of we're waiting for something to come, someone to come. So in Advent, we're waiting for, I think originally we would say the second coming of Christ. Now we think of it as we're waiting to celebrate Christmas and the coming of Jesus. And the 4 weeks of Advent mark different ways for us to sort of reflect and meditate upon God and our role in God's world. And the 4 weeks of Advent have different themes. Do you know what they are? They're the same every year. The first week is hope. The second is peace. The third is joy. And the fourth is love. And the different candles are different colors. This is a liturgical practice. which means the church has different colors for different ways that we're to sort of be in the world. So the purple color is sort of reflective, penitent. We think about our roles, we think about God, we're very prayerful. And there's one week that's a different color because it represents something that's a little bit more of an action in the world or a happiness in the world. So the week of joy is the pink candle. So you'll see us lighting the Advent candles. We'll go purple, hope, purple, peace, pink, joy, back to purple for love. And then on Christmas Eve, we'll light the Christ candle. So if you'll just join me in the spirit of prayer. Holy Creator, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together to learn more about how we understand you and relate to you. This week, we will especially be thinking about hope, the hope you bring to us, the hope that we can share with the world. Amen. This morning's gospel reading is from Mark, chapter 13, 24 through 37. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken, and they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and he commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cock crow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, keep awake. So ends this morning's reading. If you please join me in the spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my strength and my redeemer. In a typical year, I love Advent. I love the Christmas season. It's a season of waiting and watching for God, a season in which we wait especially in the spirit of hope, peace, joy, and love. And that's why I'm finding these apocalyptic readings a bit tiring. We're living in a world that seems to be in the midst of being torn down. Climate change-driven wildfires, unusually high numbers of hurricanes and tropical storms. But those things don't affect everyone. Certainly, my life in Maine was blissfully free of wildfires and hurricanes. For me, life went on just as usual. I worked, I went to church, I enjoyed a very happy, active social life. But now, for the last several months, we've had this pandemic. Have you heard about it? Unlike wildfires and hurricanes, the COVID-19 pandemic has affected us all to a certain degree. It has torn at the fabric of our society. This year, we saw the closing of churches and schools, the canceling of social gatherings and our usual holiday fare. It's been life in isolation, especially for our elders who live in congregate housing, being kept apart from their family and friends, having meals alone off of styrofoam. It seems pretty bleak. It could be worse. It seems actually maybe a little doomed. The gospel writer wrote, "The sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light." What a hard year. This year's events, coupled with a reading like this one from Mark, makes me wonder, what is going on? What is at play here? And I find that I can easily go overboard. I don't know if you all remember the comic strips with this sort of trope of the man carrying the sign that says, "The end of the world is near." Well, I've been feeling like that a little bit this year. Which is why I think it's important to take a look at the word apocalypse. From the Oxford English Dictionary, it literally means to uncover or reveal. So in the spirit of uncovering, revealing, what has the pandemic revealed to us? What has the pandemic revealed about us? What has it revealed about our society? What have we learned about ourselves? There's been good and not so good. What I find interesting is that the light that reveals the problems of our society is the same light that reveals the solution. Natural disasters, such as the pandemic, disproportionately affect the poor and minorities. The pandemic has given birth to the term essential worker. These workers are found in all areas of the medical field, as we'd expect. First responders, nurses, doctors. Added to that are retail workers, some of the poorest paid in our society. Retail workers taking some of the biggest risks. As we all know, Amazon is having a record year with all the ordering we've been doing. And Amazon is also really well known for its poor working conditions and unsafe situation for its employees, for the firing of whistleblowers who stand up for their fellow employees. As a street minister, I was actually also considered an essential worker. After all, we are pastoring to the homeless, the addicted, and the mentally ill, and that does not stop when a pandemic starts. And it was in my role as a street pastor that the reality of some of the retail workers became clear to me. As street pastors, we were given a monthly stipend of spending money so that we could buy boots and jeans and underwear, socks for folks in need. And we went to Walmart because that's where our dollars went the furthest. My first trip to our local Walmart after the beginning of the shutdown was fairly typical. But as I was walking around and looking at the people who were working there, I noticed a lot of them were older, and a lot of them were bearing the hallmarks of a life lived in poverty. And I had to wonder, why are these folks working during the pandemic? Shouldn't they be home? My cashier was a woman who waited on me regularly. We always got to chatting. And this was in the days before everyone had plexiglass up. They were just starting to put it up at the supermarket. So I asked her, "Are you going to get some plexiglass with all the people that you see here?" And she said, well, she heard they were supposed to, but she didn't know when. And it kind of opened up the floodgates of her anxiety and fear. 77 years old, diabetic, swollen ankles from standing. She had to work, and she had to work as much as possible. And I just thought, what on earth is wrong with us as a society? The pandemic has further uncovered the growing political polarization of our country. We just don't listen to each other. We move quickly into hateful language. And for some reason, we feel personally attacked when confronted with perspectives different from our own. There's no room for the other, little appreciation of each other's humanity. The sun will be darkened. And that's how it feels to me sometimes. But not all the time. The pandemic has uncovered bright spots of humanity as well. During the early days of the lockdown in Portland, my husband and I would go out for long walks. We live near a couple different nature reserves. And as we were walking down our street, I started to notice rainbows up in the windows. And they weren't just any rainbow. They were rainbows drawn by the child of the house, put up for everyone to see. And I noticed that as I noticed the rainbows, I noticed more and more of the rainbows. It was such a great feeling to see those rainbows. And as I would go on my walks, I would, you know, purposely look to see if I could see a child's drawing of a rainbow. It was a little bit of human contact, a generous and spontaneous act of love. It was a little, like, a little flare that went up that said, hey, I'm human, I'm here, and you're there, let's connect. I called it in my head the rainbow connection. I don't know if any of you are Muppets fans, but as churches, we've learned to share our rituals and our worship differently. We realize that church doesn't depend on a building. And while we're so lucky to be able to be in person, we realize that the church is actually just the people. We've learned how important it is to have multiple ways to share the worship experience and multiple ways to contact people, to be one as a faith community. As a faith community, we've learned to become flexible. We were forced to. And although we have always known that flexibility is important intellectually, we are now living into that knowledge. And that's growth. And that's a hopeful thing. We've had to cancel all kinds of social gatherings, or at least as we knew them. But we've Zoomed, and we've had drive-by parties and parades. We've met in driveways, masked, and outside. Since COVID began, my husband and I have started talking more regularly to our friends, just over the phone, not in person. It may not be the same, but we've learned how important human-to-human contact is, that connection. In a wonderful article in Yes Magazine called How to Find Joy, Even in 2020, Angelo Burrell, a Yale University researcher on joy, defines joy as this. Joy is what we feel deep in our bones when we realize and feel connected to others. Joy is what we feel deep in our bones when we realize and feel connected to others and to what is genuinely good, beautiful, and meaningful. That is, connection leads to joy, and that joy lends itself to hope. When we feel joy, we also feel hope for a better world, for more connection. When I walked along, I'd see a rainbow in a window and hope to see another, because it was a way of sharing love. These moments are of connection. They're creative. They're not staid, and they're not stagnant. They're alive. They are so important, these moments of connection, that we've learned to be flexible and look for new ways to connect with others. I think these moments of connection, to me, really point to the movement of the Holy Spirit. I think they reveal the Holy Spirit in action in our world. There's a lovely and traditional way to describe the Trinity. And it's the Father in relationship to the Son. The Holy Spirit is the love that connects and binds them. And it's that love that connects and binds us all to each other and to God. So you see, in these bleak times, when we feel that deep connection, that's the sacred breaking through, making itself known to us, looking for new and creative ways to connect with our faith community, friends, neighbors, family, can, I believe, awaken us to the movement of the Holy Spirit. These shared connections, these joyful moments awaken us to the sacred in our everyday lives. And if we keep awake to the sacred in our everyday lives and the joy and the hope that it brings, what a different world we would live in. We have enormous problems in our society, heartbreaking problems. And it can feel like the sun has been darkened and the moon is not giving its light. And we may want to see the Son of Man coming in clouds, coming down to fix things for us. And there's some satisfaction in thinking of some grand action. But I think thinking that way distracts us from God's movement in our everyday lives. God's movement in those rainbow drawings, to the birthday drive-bys, those moments where we share love and connection in generous and spontaneous ways. Those little moments. These little moments can work as signposts, pointing us towards God's loving community. Markers on the path that will help guide us as we turn our attention to working for a better, more just, and more loving world. Amen. As we move into joys and concerns, I would like to start maybe with some things that you're hoping for in this upcoming year or for the future as part of our prayer today. Do we have any thoughts on hope?
Healing as a country.
Yes, yeah. Get the vaccine, that it works, and we can be stronger together. Any other thoughts of hope? Yes. Mother Earth? For the food and water that Mother Earth provides. Any other thoughts of hope? Any prayers that you would like to include this morning? Joys and concerns.
Prayers for my sister who's in an extended care facility in Pennsylvania and has tested positive.
Oh. Prayers for Mary's sister who is in an extended living place in Pennsylvania who's tested positive. Continued prayers for Flossie, continued cards and calls. If there are no more, please join me in the spirit of prayer. Please hold those in your minds, close to your hearts. Holy One, Advent is the time of waiting and watching for you. It is the time of carols and comforting familiar stories of Jesus' birth. While this year Advent and Christmas will be different from years past, we still wait in the spirit of hope. Hope for a better, more loving world. Hope for healed relationships. Hope for new beginnings and peace. But waiting and hoping are not always easy. We ask you, God, to share your love and hope with those who feel especially alone this season, with those who suffer the pain of loss, with those suffering from addiction and mental illness. We also pray for Mary's sister, continued prayers for Flossie. Grant us peace and understanding. In your holy name, we pray. Amen. Now, if you would join me in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever. Amen. As you go out today, go out in peace. Go out as a people filled with the loving hope of God. Amen.